Once again this August, millions of people from the Central Plains to the East Coast will be at risk for severe weather starting today. The driving weather pattern that's producing an unusual amount of storm systems this month is this guy right here, or rather, the third of his kind. More on that in a minute, because at the same time, the Pacific Ocean is blowing up with tropical activity, including another system poised to take a similar track as Dora did, and maybe even another system that will bring some rain and possibly winds up into the southwestern states if it takes the right track. Moreover, the Pacific Northwest is dealing with a cascade of wildfire problems in the midst of some of their worst heat this year. In this video, we're going to cover all of that in depth, so you can be prepared for what's to come now and what's up next. Meteorologist Andy Hill here at the forecasting desk. Let's start by diving into the severe weather risks day by day. Yesterday, we had an enhanced risk from the Storm Prediction Center slightly displaced from where the bulk of the activity took place in central to eastern Ohio, as well as southwestern Pennsylvania. A few lower end, but still damaging tornadoes in the red dots did occur in this region, and the system will continue off to the east for eastern Canada and northeastern New England, but now it lacks most of the severe weather ingredients needed for a widespread outbreak. Thus, the focus today, August 13th, shifts to the Central Plains into parts of the Ohio River and Mississippi River Valley, with an enhanced corridor extremely similar to what this area saw last Wednesday, August 9th. But this storm will have slightly different characteristics to that one. Namely, the tornado threat will actually exist along a warm front this time as compared to a cold front last time. That warm front will be where storms want to rotate the most in the lowest levels here, which is the primary ingredient they need to become tornadic. So who's concerned with that? Well, generally, the Ozarks are back in the area with the highest chance for tornadoes, which looks to be about middle of the road in terms of severe risk. There will be attendant wind and hail risks as well in the enhanced corridor, as well as the slight risk in yellow surrounding it. So particularly Joplin, Springfield, Missouri, Mountain Home down here in Arkansas, and all the way east through Poplar Bluff and Cape Girardeau will want to be paying attention today, just like you did last Wednesday, August 9th. And just like last time, it'll be two rounds. This morning storm currently traveling through southern Missouri, which the models are having a terrible time resolving, followed by possible clearing or sporadic showers, and then intense new development. This intense development will take place in the evening and will move west to east even past midnight before it merges with that cold front moving through. So you can see the warm front storms there blowing up in southwest Missouri, and then that cold front overtakes them in a line that also extends all the way back west into the Texas Panhandle and western Oklahoma. In addition to the severe hazards, there's also a 3 out of 4 risk for flash flooding in place here, where those multiple rounds of storms are expected to move through. I know we talk about these flooding threats from the Weather Prediction Center often, but they really are a big problem that you should be mindful of, rather than afraid of. Y'all are going to take multiple beatings today as of watching this video or later on in the night, so don't be scared, be prepared. And just like what happened yesterday, this particular storm system will continue east and give the eastern Great Lakes, Mid-Atlantic, and parts of the Northeast another stormy day on Monday the 14th. For now, it seems less intense than the last couple of systems to move through for y'all, but this is subject to change. And of course, everyone will experience it differently depending on where the strongest storms actually set up. The memo is that daytime will bring lines of storms from west to east, generally in front of and along the same cold front that is impacting the central states today. These sporadic clusters and line segments all around this area will pose primarily a damaging wind threat, but also a small chance for a tornado as well. And as such, since it looks a little bit less organized compared to the last few storm systems to blow through here, I don't anticipate a live stream covering this day's risks unless a major uptrend occurs. After that, on Tuesday the 15th, the coastal Atlantic here will see the remnants of that storm, the last of this system, but unfortunately, on the broader scale, it's not over. On Wednesday, it's the upper Midwest into eastern Manitoba and northwestern Ontario. This outlined risk area from the Storm Prediction Center may be a little bit more disorganized at this place, but that does mean that on Thursday, it's the Great Lakes and you guys in Michigan, all the way over here to southern Ontario. And yep, on Friday, that's you guys in the Northeast, once again getting a stormy period. So severe weather looks likely once again through the end of this week, but this time it's going to be on this northern corridor as opposed to the southern to mid-Atlantic one we've seen recently. So, are we done after that? Well, for most of us, yes, we will get a brief break. Check out this loop of rain that falls in a one-day period. Watch the storms move through where orange and red is a couple inches of rain in that day. You can see our system we start with today drop a good amount of stratiform rain up here in the upper Midwest, eventually moving through Toronto as it carries the severe risks further to the south. Then, our next system starting Wednesday drops a good amount of that rain through Alberta, Saskatchewan, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba before making it down this way into the northern states in that corridor we highlighted. So there it goes through, giving us a bunch of rain, and finally, 7 days out, we may have another severe weather maker in the northern plains and parts of the Midwest. But most of this map is dry, except maybe a little bit of monsoon moisture right here from the remnants of Eugene, as well as some of the monsoon moisture traversing up through the Great Basin and into the Pacific Northwest. This is reflected nicely on this map of expected precipitation from the Climate Prediction Center for a week out from now. You can see after our active period of severe weather, we actually fall off a bit in terms of expected rainfall, just like we saw in the accumulated precip map. While it might not be too much rain overall, we do see above average chances here in the Pacific Northwest primarily. And to go along with that rainfall outlook are these temperatures for the same time. So why does it look like this? Well, here's the culprit. A big old ridge is going to start building in a few miles above your heads here in the central states at that time. That will keep things rain-free, sunny, and hot in the belly of the ridge next weekend into next week. And that will also serve as the periphery for any storms that sneak their way in. They're going to travel around the ridge, just like we saw that attempt at precipitation a week out from now. Now, let's take a thorough look at the tropics, especially the Pacific Basin, since the Atlantic will remain quiet over the next week. You're going to want to pay attention to this. Tropical cyclone activity over here is intense, as we're looking at not one, not two, not three, not four, but five areas of interest. The first one we'll focus on is the weakening Hurricane/Typhoon Dora, which is the strongest hurricane so far this season overall. As most of you know, Dora has national media attention for various factors, but most particularly its association with the Hawaii wildfires. So to start, let me cover what occurred meteorologically here. A strong pressure gradient, or difference between high and low pressure, set up over Hawaii, circled as Dora passed to the south on that low pressure there. A strong pressure gradient, or difference between high and low pressure, set up over Hawaii as Dora passed to the south, denoted by the L. Around that strong pressure gradient, strong surface winds resulted and were funneled through the gaps in the Hawaii Islands. At the same time, a plume of dry air streamed over Hawaii from the northeast, which was another catalyst for downslope windstorms on the other side of mountains from the wind direction. And this is what impacted Lahaina. So, like you've been hearing, Dora did actually accentuate this pressure gradient, intensified the gradient, thus making the wind stronger, but due to how far away it was from the islands, it actually had only a minor effect and was not the major reason for this occurring. This graphic from the wonderful Philippe Papin, who also graduated UNCA several years before me, details what happens in this scenario with and without Dora. So you can see his analysis as an employee at the National Hurricane Center concludes with Dora actually only resulting in an increase of winds of about 4 to 5 mile per hour. And that 4 to 5 mile an hour increase would be what occurred simultaneously with the Lahaina fire. Definitely go and follow Dr. Papin. He deserves all the love in the weather world. You can find his handle here. Dora is the second storm recorded at hurricane strength in the East Pacific, the Central Pacific, and also in typhoon strength in the West Pacific, which is equal to hurricane strength. And amazingly, Dora almost organized in the Atlantic Basin all the way back on July 20th, where it traveled as an invest or an area of interest for a while before crossing into the Pacific and organizing. So Dora has existed for nearly a month at this point and is right on her last breaths. Certainly a storm overall to never forget, and may those who suffered from the wildfires in any capacity find peace. Next up, our area of interest that will take much the same path as Dora did to the south of Hawaii. Due to the reasons discussed surrounding the pressure gradient and unfortunate timing of the dry air bloom, this area of interest should not accentuate wildfire conditions on the islands of Hawaii. However, there is a small chance of a closer glancing blow from a tropical system if this one does head more to the northwest. So it's one to keep an eye on about 5 to 7 days out from this video. This storm will be named either Greg or Hillary, depending on a competing organizing storm and which one forms first. Though if it takes its time, it could actually be named a Coney in the Central Pacific instead. Third, Tropical Storm Fernanda, as of this video, is right in the middle of all of this chaos in the Eastern Pacific Basin. This storm will likely strengthen rapidly, maybe even hinging on major hurricane status as it meanders to the west. If it disintegrates after this graphic, after August 17th, then the remnants of Fernanda may make it all the way over to the islands of Hawaii. So that will be in about 10 days or so into late August. We'll see whether Fernanda holds together until then or not, but my forecast is for it to fall apart in more hostile upper-level conditions before reaching the islands. Fourth, holy moly, is what will very likely become the other of Greg or Hillary, this guy right here. Now, right now, it doesn't look like much, but many of the latest model runs actually take this all the way up to hurricane strength and slam it right into Baja California and the Southwest states. Now, don't fret. If this worst-case scenario does happen over a week out from now, there is plenty of wind shear in place here in the southwestern states and before it that will absolutely rip this storm apart before it reaches the U.S. mainland. So to back that forecast up, here are several more model runs that also take it straight up into California. The previous six-hour run here, and the previous six-hour run also from the GFS here with the same track. We can also take a look at the storm from the Canadian model here, which does intensify it somewhat and drags it right up into the southwestern states as well for model consensus. However, one model, the European model, keeps this storm pretty weak, but still developing into a tropical storm. And because it's weaker, it won't be as tall of a storm overall. That means, according to this model, that it will actually be steered out off to open sea instead of to the US. This happens because the average wind direction that impacts a storm changes when you include winds higher up in the atmosphere. This difference in the models happens because when a model shows a taller storm, the average wind direction impacting that storm will change because the winds change as you go higher up in the atmosphere. The taller that storm is in general, the more the winds in the upper levels will also steer it. So if this system does in fact make a beeline up to the California coast, what does that mean for those impacted? Well, kind of like Eugene earlier this month, it means another round of general raininess, storminess, and probably a fresher breeze than most experienced with Eugene when it made its way up here. Since we're still a couple days out from this storm organizing currently, its track is heavily subject to change, as where the low pressure center actually organizes will heavily alter its path. Regardless, this is certainly going to be one of the most interesting tropical storms to track this season. So here's a look at the wind shear should this actually form and move into the area. You can see that bright red area over Southern California and the Baja Peninsula right as the storm moves into it, as going to rapidly shred it apart, just as I mentioned. And finally, fifth is what's pictured here, Typhoon Lan, which will remain a low-end typhoon in a general weakening trend as it approaches the Japan mainland here. So this is expected to make landfall somewhere in the Kyoto area of Japan. It'll bring a lot of rain, first and foremost, alongside gusty conditions where it does make landfall on Tuesday. So flooding is my main concern Tuesday morning into the afternoon in this region of Japan on Honshu. Thereafter, the typhoon or the tropical storm will accelerate to the northeast and affect the island of Hokkaido on Thursday. So, five tropical storms down, a complete 180. The wildfire season in the west of the US is just starting to reach its peak. Relevant to that are dry thunderstorms, the combination of little rainfall but lots of lightning. In peak fire season, those are prime grounds for the ignition of new wildfires, especially since there's plenty of dry vegetation ready to burn in the northern coastal range and the Cascades primarily. So along with your friends in the south and southeast roasting in these excessive heat warnings, I'm focusing big time on the Pacific Northwest. Together, y'all will both roast this week, but over here we have accompanying red flag warnings in the pink through the mountains and the mountain passes. Some of these warning areas and even down to Northern California may experience dry thunderstorms through this period. So if you've received this information over there, then you've done the best you can so far. You're practically set now that you're weather aware. Fire weather aware, that is. But it wouldn't hurt to have a little bit of a fire plan in place just in case. Otherwise, I hope you stay safe in the heat. Be mindful of the heat and all the risks that it poses and make sure you're drinking plenty of water. Once you're done with that heat wave, please keep your neighbors in the central states in mind as that same ridge that's giving you the heat now will migrate over here and give us these above average temperatures. And until then, thank you for watching this doozy of a video. It gets a bit tough to be a national forecaster when severe and tropical overlap like this. But I genuinely gave it my all to get all of this information into this video in a succinct and scientifically sound manner. Please let me know if you enjoyed it or found it useful in any fashion in the comments. And also be sure to recommend it to others too. We're a team in the realm of weather awareness. You and me. So I hope to see you in the next one.